Today, in a rare event, both Missouri senators, along with all eight of our members of Congress, will join us to talk about issues across the state. From north to south, east to west, we tackle all the issues facing the Show Me State. Many parts of the state are reopening, while others remain locked down. But questions remain. Is it too soon? What happens if we see another spike? And how will we pay the bills? Tonight, a statewide town hall meeting on COVID-19.
Good evening, I'm John Brown. Welcome to our COVID-19 Congressional Town Hall. Tonight, we're talking with lawmakers from across the state of Missouri to get an update on how each region of Missouri is doing, what still needs to be done, and what the future holds as we try and get back to some semblance of normal. This show is reaching nearly the entire state of Missouri this evening, covering 99 counties, comprising about 5 million people. This Missouri-wide town hall is being seen on Fox 2 and KPLR 11 in St. Louis, Fox 4 in Kansas City, Ozarks Fox in Springfield, Fox 22 in Columbia and Jefferson City, KFVS 12 in Cape Girardeau, and KSN in Joplin. And we have the entire Missouri congressional delegation joining us for this virtual town hall. From District 1, Representative Lacey Clay. From District 2, Representative Ann Wagner. District 3, Representative Blaine Luchtemeyer. District 4, Representative Vicki Hartzler. District 5, Representative Emmanuel Cleaver. District 6, Representative Sam Graves. District 7, Representative Billy Long. And from District 8, Representative Jason Smith. And we also have our two senators, Josh Hawley and Roy Blunt. Both of them are joining us from Washington, D.C., where the Senate is debating the next steps in the battle against COVID-19. Now, many parts of Missouri have been hit extremely hard with COVID-19, but other areas of the state have seen few, if any, cases of coronavirus at this point. But one thing is for sure, the entire state is suffering, whether it be physically, economically, or even socially. Now, here's a look at the gradient map of the cases, county by county in Missouri as of today. As you can see, the areas in dark blue have a high number of cases. But the counties with the lighter shades have fewer, with some of the counties in white having zero reported cases thus far. So we've set the stage. Now let's begin with Senator Josh Hawley from Washington, D.C. Senator Hawley, thanks for making time for us today. Now let's begin with this. You've been very critical of not only how China has handled their response to the coronavirus, but also how their businesses are possibly harming American companies. You even filed a bill to hold the Chinese Communist Party responsible. What do you hope comes from that?
Justice. I hope justice comes from it. Now, listen, China is the one, the Communist Chinese Party are the ones who have inflicted this pandemic on the world. They knew about this virus long before they told the world. They tried to silence their own doctors. They put doctors in jail, for heaven's sakes. They inflicted this on their own people, and then they allowed it to become a global pandemic. They need to be held responsible. They should pay back the United States and other countries, our allies, for the expenses that they have forced on us. Think of all the lost jobs. Think of all the people who have lost their health care because of this. The Chinese Communist Party is responsible at the end of the day, and we need to hold them accountable.
I saw the vice president just said that, you know, we may be approaching a Cold War part two. Do you foresee something like that happen where China fights back and says, we're not doing that, and then we get into a stalemate?
Well, that's going to be all on the Chinese. I mean, it's going to be the Chinese Communist Party's decision there. I can tell you this, though. I think the days of us sitting back and hoping that China will treat us better, those need to be over. And we need to quit waiting for China to be nice to us. It's time that we took action right now to secure our jobs. We need more jobs in the state of Missouri. We need to bring them back from overseas. We need to bring back our production from overseas. We need to bring back our supply chains from overseas. We shouldn't be dependent on China for anything that matters. And we need to be in the driver's seat when it comes to our own economy going forward. That has got to be a top priority coming out of this health emergency.
Senator, since this show is going out all over the state, we've been taking viewer questions. Here's one from Terry in St. Louis. She writes, since community-wide mask compliance has been shown to greatly reduce the transmission of COVID-19, why would Missouri hesitate to adopt a statewide requirement? Should we all be wearing masks, I guess, is the question here, Senator?
You know, I think that it's really important that regional leaders be able to make decisions that make sense for their region. Missouri's a big state. And we've got a lot of different areas in the state. Yeah, Southwest Missouri is a different place from St. Louis, which is a different place from Kansas City, which is different from Southeast or Mid-Mo, and you can go all around the horn again. So I think the important thing here is that every region be able to follow the guidelines and the staged reopening that makes sense for them. It's needs to be a data-driven decision. Let's make sure our hospitals have capacity. Let's make sure we're getting testing resources to places that really need it, especially community health centers. And let's make sure that we're supporting, in a health sense, the frontline workers. But we need flexibility nationally. I don't want to see a one-size-fits-all national policy. I want to see regional leaders be able to do what's best for their regions across our country and across our state.
Governor Parson is urging Missourians to support Missouri businesses as much as possible so we can help rebuild our own economy. What can you do from the federal level to support our businesses that have really been decimated by something that's really out of our and the business's control?
What we've got to do is focus on jobs. We've got 30 million people in this country who are now claiming unemployment, over 400,000 in the state of Missouri. That is too many. So any further relief that comes from Congress needs to be focused on getting people their jobs back. And that's why I've introduced a plan that would get people their jobs back right now. It would help businesses rehire every worker who has been laid off because of the coronavirus. It would protect the job of every worker in our state until this emergency is over, and every worker in the nation. And it would give families that security of knowing they're going to be able to keep their job. They're going to be able to keep the health care they get on the job. This, I think, it's one of the most important things the United States Senate and Congress can do right now is jobs, jobs, jobs. Let's secure them. Let's get them back for the workers of our state.
All right, Senator, I know we only have a couple seconds left. What's your word to Missourians as we're trying to recover and get the state reopened once again?
You know, I would just say that I want to thank the healthcare professionals and the people who are on the front lines who have made it possible for us to be where we are today. And I want to thank the folks of Missouri. We are bending the curve here. We are going to break the back of this epidemic. We are going to be victorious. There's no doubt about it. And we're all in it together. So we're going to stand strong. I have every confidence that Missouri is going to emerge from this stronger than we were before. And I hope that we will continue to do our part. I know I'm going to in Washington to make sure that we get jobs back for the people of our state, that we secure our critical jobs going forward, we stand up to China, and we do what is necessary to protect our state.
Again, Missouri Senator Josh Hawley up in Washington, D.C., thanks for your time today. And coming up later in the show, we'll talk with Senator Roy Blunt to discuss his new proposal that's making some national news today regarding a vaccine and treatment. Now let's focus on specific portions of the state. We're going to go across the entire state tonight. Congressman Lacey Clay is District 1. He represents the St. Louis area, which is by far the hardest hit portion of the state. Congressman, thanks for joining us. You were at Christian Northeast Hospital this evening. First of all, give us an update on what's happening in your district as you continue to deal with really such a high volume of cases there.
Thanks for having us on this congressional town hall, John. And I'm coming to you live tonight from the epic center of the COVID-19 pandemic in Missouri, North St. Louis County. After tonight's town hall meeting, I'll be helping a local restaurant provide a special dinner for all our healthcare heroes who work here at Christian Hospital on the front lines of this emergency. And as of tonight, St. Louis City and County, we've recorded almost 5,000 confirmed COVID-19 cases and almost 300 deaths. And this community is experiencing an unprecedented public health crisis, unlike anything that we have seen in over a century.
You know, Congressman, we've heard a lot about the CARES Act, which you've been a part of, the Paycheck Protection Program as well. We're now finding out that those aren't covering everything, nor everyone. You are on the Financial Services Committee, so what would you like to see future legislation do to help people in your district recover really in the most efficient manner possible?
Well, the Financial Services Committee is incorporating into CARES Act 2 some of what was left out and some of the holes that we didn't fill in the CARES Act. One was a lesson that we learned from the 2008 housing crisis, and that was to prevent the foreclosure crisis from happening. So Chairwoman Maxine Waters and I have introduced the bill to stop all evictions, to help landlords out through forbearance and to stop all foreclosure for a year after this, until this pandemic is over. And we think that that will go a long way in keeping people in their home, keeping renters in their apartments, and helping the landlords who are also under stress,
yeah.
Because they still have to pay those property taxes.
Yeah, Congressman, that's a huge issue, especially in St. Louis with what people are facing, not paying their rent, not paying the mortgages here. We got one more for you here very quickly. Viewer question, Michael from St. Louis says, what do you say to people who may think this is being blown out of proportion? You've seen it. What do you say to other people who aren't seeing it?
Here's what I say is that the Spanish flu of 1918 and 19 went through a period initially where there were deaths that occurred and infections. Then we dropped our guard in this country and hundreds of thousands of more Americans died. So I don't want to see that happen again. And I say to all Missourians, let's follow the medical advice of public health professionals, of the CDC, follow the guidance, wear your mask.
All right.
Protect others.
All right, Congressman, we're going to have to leave it on that one. I'm going to have to cut
China.
You. Okay, sound good. Congressman, we're going to have to cut you right there because we got to get to all the other delegates. Appreciate your time tonight, Congressman Lacey Clay. We're now going to head to the western part of the state and District 4. That's where we find Representative Vicki Hartzler. Now, Congresswoman, you have the state's largest university in your district. We're, of course, talking about Mizzou. We have a lot of parents and students watching right now wondering what the future looks like this fall. So what can you tell us about the conversations that you've had with the university officials?
Well, they are taking the steps necessary to make sure that our students still have the best education possible. This has been a challenge for them. It's been a challenge for the students as they've had to return home and have their semesters cut short, and they had to complete their classes online. The university has given $25 million back in tuition and housing fees, and has taken a financial toll. So they're in the process of looking at what steps need to be taken to keep them financially strong. The president has said he's going to have to look at realignment, restructuring, and other steps. The administration has taken pay cuts themselves, and many of the staff members and faculty have been furloughed or have had pay cuts. But they are determined to make sure that this university continues to be the flagship university in our state. And I think there's a lot of hope that next fall, everything will be able to return pretty much back to normal. Students will be able to go back on campus and we'll be able to move forward as a university.
Yeah, I'm sure parents and students are both very hopeful that that happens. Okay, you have an interesting district because you have Whiteman Air Force Base and Fort Leonard Wood in your district, and you're also on the Armed Services Committee. What special precautions are taking place to make sure that our military members are still training while also remaining safe?
Right. It's very important that we do both, for sure. Down at Fort Leonard Wood, they're still accepting recruits. Of course, that's one of our premier basic training sites for our Army. And they're taking special precaution with these recruits as they come on board. They're closely monitored for a couple of weeks. If there's an individual that shows symptoms or health problems, they are isolated and in a special barracks, and they receive special medical care and attention and monitored by medical personnel. And the recruits are wearing face masks, they're practicing social distancing, but the mission continues and it is vital. We cannot stop our national defenses, our ability to train our recruits. On Whiteman Air Force Base, they too have limited access to the installation itself, but the training missions are continuing. The maintainers are wearing face masks. They've changed the way that they are doing debriefings over the radio versus maybe in person. They've had individuals come back from the spring bomber task force deployment, and they were isolated for 14 days. So they're taking extra precautions. but yet still keeping their eyes on the mission and making sure that our nation stays safe.
All right, very quickly here, question from a viewer. Missouri, of course, one of the nation's top producers of food. Your district is key to that production. Colleen from Clinton asks, what is Congress doing to protect our food supply? And Congresswoman, we only have about 30 seconds, about a minute. What do you say to her?
Well, there is in provisions of the CARES Act to support our farmers who've been especially hit. And then we're looking at our meat packing plants and doing everything we can to, one, make sure that the workers stay safe, and two, make sure that these plants can continue to stay open so that that food product ends up on our grocery shelves and our consumers are able to buy it and put it on their families' tables.
Once again, Representative Vicki Hartzler, 4th District of Missouri, we appreciate your time tonight. Well, as we know, Missouri attracts millions of tourists each and every year to places like Lake of the Ozarks and Branson. Still to come, we speak with a Missouri lawmaker who's on the president's task force on reopening the economy to see what the future holds for one of our state's biggest industries. When will we be able to have those big gatherings and big events once again in the state? And Senator Roy Blunt made big news this week when he announced that the federal government is going to fast-track drug production and vaccine development. So they're going to do it Shark Tank style. We have much more to come with our full congressional delegation all in one place. You're watching the COVID-19 Congressional Town Hall. Luke DeMeyer, but we began with Representative Billy Long. He represents District 7, which covers Southwest Missouri. That includes Springfield and Joplin, along with the Branson area. Now, Congressman Long, you are on the President's Council on Reopening the American Economy. What are you hearing from that group that can maybe give us some sort of insight into what happens next in Missouri?
Well, what we're hearing, and it is a bipartisan committee, which is very good, so we could work with the Democrats, and it's really interesting to hear the Democrats on the call with the President and with Larry Kudlow and different folks telling them what a good job that they think that the White House is doing. And one thing we're hearing is that we've got to get people back to work, definitely. And infrastructure is something that I've been on the bandwagon for a long time. And the President mentioned a few days ago that he wants a big infrastructure package. And I think the time has come. This is my ninth year in Congress. I've been there a little over 9 years, I guess, in Congress. And ever since I've been there, infrastructure has gone begging. And so this is a great chance to put a lot of people out there to work and fix the locks and dams and get 5G out there to the rural communities and things so that kids can study out in the country, just like the kids in town can study. So we're hearing different things from different parts of the country, as you might imagine. They have different things going on in Washington, the state of Washington, and they do in Oregon and down in Florida and up in Connecticut. So just a wide variety of things. And a lot of these different governors are putting different restrictions on their people. And there's a lot of pushback in states that you wouldn't think. California is really fed up with what their governor has locked them down on out there. So that's the type of thing that we had a call today with Larry Kudlow and everyone on that committee. And it was a very good call to just kind of get, you know, everyone's opinion, Democrat, Republican alike. Yeah.
Now, Congressman, in your district are some of the biggest tourist attractions in the country, really. We're talking Branson, part of the Ozarks. Do you foresee big gatherings taking place this year? And if not, what does the future look like for that region?
I think that depends on the public. I think that if we can get the confidence back in the public that, hey, it's okay to come out, this thing, we were told at first that there's a very good chance that it'll sway or go away in the warmer weather months. So hopefully, and that's when Branson shines, is in the warm weather. It's a great family location, great place to bring the kids. Everyone's welcome, grandma, to the newborn baby. And so, yeah, we think that things will come back in the Branson area and come back in a big way. So we're looking forward to get people back in the theaters down there. Now they may have to set a row apart or have every other row empty and families, six people in one section if they're in one family, then 6 feet over the next group. But we're a pretty resilient bunch down here in Southwest Missouri, and I think we can make it work.
Yeah, Congressman, viewer question tonight. This one comes from Charles in Rogersville. He writes, now that we have relaxed stay-at-home orders, if we see an uptick in cases, what should the government do to get it under control again? What are your thoughts on that one?
Being on the committee to reopen the government, that's one of the first questions I was asked by a member of the press was, what signs are you looking for to open up the government? And I said, well, just the opposite is true. I'm looking for an uptick to tell us not to reopen or that we need to slow down the reopening process. So if we have anything COVID-related in this area, I think that's when we need to back off and reassess. And but this social distancing has been fine. You know, the handshake, I don't think people are hiding a broad axe behind their back anymore. So I think we can do away with the handshake, do away with, you know, standing real close to people all the time.
Yeah, those days may be gone, Congressman. All right, once again, Congressman Billy Long down in the Springfield area tonight. We're going to head now to the 3rd District. That's Congressman Blaine Lukemeyer. That includes Jefferson City, Lake of the Ozarks, and much of eastern mid-Missouri. He joins us from St. Elizabeth on his birthday, no less. Congressman, you're a community banker by profession, so you understand these issues the financial institutions are facing. So what does need to be done next to make sure that people still have their incomes flowing while also still keeping them safe?
Well, I'm like Billy. I sit on the President's task force to open up the economy again. And I think, you know, my suggestions to the group have been that from a financial standpoint, I don't want a repeat of 08 and 09 whenever the regulators came in and got rid of entire books of business for the banks. It devastated the communities. It devastated the businesses. It devastated the banks as well. And we took a long, long time to get out of this mess. So I have a bill that I think can be very effective in allowing the regulators, requiring the regulators to give forbearance to the banks that in turn then can give forbearance to their customers, the businesses, which can then hire the people, which can then keep the economies going and growing. And I think that to me is very important. And in the CARES Act, there were a couple of different provisions that talked about different rules and regulations that we suspended, waived, or changed. And I think we need to continue those. And if something didn't work in a crisis, I think we probably need to take a really close look at it and see what we needed at all.
Yeah.
So those are two recommendations I've made on the financial institution side. The other side is with regards to income flowing to the individuals, I think a payroll tax cut makes a lot of sense. I've been on some calls with a lot of national economists, and I know the president's a big supporter of this. It makes sense to allow people to keep their own money so that they can invest and spend as they feel fit for themselves and their families. It allows businesses to keep their own money and invest as they see fit for their own businesses. And I think we saw the tax cut back in that we passed in 2017, how it worked, how it got the economy going, kept it going. And I think this is a way, if we need to goose the economy to keep money flowing to the people, would probably be the best way to do it. It's no red tape that away. The people get the money directly. There's no government intervention. And I think it's a good way to keep the bureaucrats out of the middle of this, quite frankly.
All right.
Well,
you also have Lake of the Ozarks in your district. I grew up there, not exactly known for social distancing, and people, summer's coming up, they're going to want to get together. So Don from Lake of the Ozarks asked, what is your advice for not only your constituents, but also for the businesses in that area to make sure the lake doesn't become a hotspot later on this summer?
Well, I think, you know, the president's task force has come out and indicated that UV rays are actually a good way to thwart the coronavirus. So being outside, you know, playing golf, boating on the lake, you know, laying around on the docks, that's a good thing to be able to do. Most of the time you're social distancing when you're doing that, so you really don't have a lot of problem with that. Obviously the nightlife, which is a big part of the Lake of the Ozarks, that may be a different story, but I think our American people, and especially the people in the state of Missouri, are doing a really good job. I was out over the last couple of weeks, and the people and the businesses were doing a good job of adjusting and adapting to this new norm of trying to keep people at distance and yet be able to conduct business. I think they can figure this out. I think that the businesses can figure it out, and I think the people can figure out a way to make this all happen. All right. And I think as the summer goes along, we'll have more and more information. We'll probably have more and more drugs that can actually be effective against this. So I think as we go along, this will be a moot point. But initially, yeah, from Memorial Day for the next few weeks, it may be a little bit different than normal. But I think by midsummer, we should be back to normal.
All right, Congressman Blaine Luchtmeyer, appreciate your time tonight. We're now heading to the district surrounding the city of St. Louis. That's District 2, Representative Ann Wagner. Now, Congresswoman, St. Louis County has more cases than any other place in the state and about half the deaths at last count. Give us an assessment of what you're seeing and hearing throughout your really diverse district.
It is a diverse district, and it's basically the suburbs of St. Louis County, and not every region is the same. We see a very different, certainly the urban and suburban area that represent. And what I'm hearing a lot from small business owners that are frustrated. They are they're scared. They're concerned that their entire life work and the business that they have built is going to fall apart, and they're going to have nothing left for their family and their workers. So we, through the CARES Act, on a bipartisan basis, worked on the Paycheck Protection Program, and we have been able to get these small businesses loans that, and some forgiveness of those loans if they're able to stay attached to their employers. So this is our employees. This is a way for the workers to stay on with their employers and to have a business and a job to go back to. So I'm hearing from a lot of small businesses. My parents were small business owners, small carpet stores, and the concern and the stress would come from that. Then I'm also hearing from that mother who's teleworking from her home in Baldwin, like I am right now, a spouse that's furloughed, three kids that she's trying to homeschool, and on top of get meals out and the whole bit. It's incumbent upon me and my team and my staff to provide the services, the support, and the resources that we've legislated for. So anybody can go to wagner.house.gov, call my district office at 636-779-5449, and we will help. Stimulus checks.
All right, Congressman, very quickly, I want to get to this last question. You're about out of time. We get tons of emails about what you're talking about there, especially people say that they're not able to get unemployment, they're running out of money. So we have a question here. We have Kimberly from St. Louis, and she writes here, applied for unemployment on March 22nd. I still have not started receiving benefits. Why not? It's been 7 weeks. I have no income. We have heard more of this story than anything else. What do you encourage people to do? Because I understand a lot of folks are getting to dire straits here.
Yeah, Kimberly, I feel, I know this frustration and the pain that you're going through, and we are working as hard as we can with the Division of Employment Security. Employment, unemployment insurance benefits are distributed through and through the Missouri State Department of Labor. Working with them to make sure that they get their and working and able to get you your unemployment check. Through, again, the CARES Act, what the federal government did is we added an additional 13 weeks of unemployment benefits to the you're already Missouri. Then, on top of that, added an additional $600 per week that'll go all the way back to late March and extend all the way through July. So if you call my office at 636-779-5449 or go to wagner.house.gov, you will talk to a real person who will be able to help navigate through the unemployment benefit system that that the state of Missouri is charged with distributing. But you know, most of all, let's all be safe. Let's build the confidence that we need to get our economy open, to keep us all healthy and strong. These are difficult times, but I know that the constituents that I have the privilege of serving will pull together in order to get this. All right, get through this.
Thank you, Congresswoman. Now, it broke up just a little bit there. We knew some technology would get to us eventually. So if you want more information, make sure you go to your local congressman. You can get all the information from there. Ann Wagner, thank you so much. Still to come on this COVID-19 congressional town hall, we speak with Missouri Senator Roy Blunt. We talk with him about making sure that medical equipment and pharmaceuticals are made here in the U.S. so we don't have to deal with this all over again. And one of our members of Congress is also a pilot and on the Transportation Committee. We'll get his thoughts on what summer travel may look like. You're watching our statewide special presentation, COVID-19, a congressional town hall. Welcome back to our COVID-19 Congressional Town Hall. We have our eight state representatives standing by, but first we're going to go back to Washington, D.C., and our senior senator, Roy Blunt, this evening. Senator, we appreciate you joining us on the statewide town hall broadcast today. Now, you're the chairman of the Senate Appropriations Subcommittee, more or less meaning you're in contact with the heads of all these key agencies like CDC, HHS, and NIH. What are they telling you right now that will likely have an impact on us in the future here in Missouri?
Well, John, these are the committees that people in the last couple of months have suddenly begun to hear a lot about. And I think they're working together in ways that we have always hoped they could, in terms of moving forward quickly on treatment, on testing, on a vaccine, trying to figure out how they can develop new partnerships with pharmaceutical companies and others to try to really have all of those things on a two-track process where we're ahead of where we would have been at any other time in all of those things that we need to deal with the virus and then eventually to emerge from the virus with a vaccine.
Yeah, I'm curious too, because you made news this week when you see the headline Shark Tank, right? So you're looking for what, the newest and most revolutionary ways to get things done quickly in kind of a Shark Tank format here. Explain what you're doing.
Well, absolutely. We gave $1 billion. This is something Senator Alexander, who's the chairman of the authorizing committee, I'm the chairman of the appropriating committee. We've worked together for 2 months now to try to come up with a unique way to fast forward the decision-making process. And in 5 days after the bill was signed, the National Institute of Health had a Shark Tank up and running. They had 400 responses in the very first day. Now the job is for those Shark Tank experts to narrow those responses down. What we want to do is say, let's get the four things that have at least a 50% chance of being successful, and let's go ahead and start toward production with all four of them. So by the time they've gone through the final test, let's say it's a vaccine, one of those or two of those or however many got through the final test would already be ready to go out and be available rather than be 30 days away or 60 days away from Missourians and people all over the country being able to get that vaccine. So we're trying to buy time here with a concept that's a little different than what the federal government's ever done before, but I think it's going to work.
Is that what it's going to take to get back to normal? Either, well, first a treatment and then a vaccine, because it's kind of hard to see everything getting back to the way it was until we have both those things in place.
The three things we need to be focused on are the vaccine, which probably takes the longest, but we're trying hard to get that done. If we can at all, set a record and get that done by the end of this year. Therapeutics, treatment, which also looking for the things that work short of the vaccine to get you through the virus better when you get it. And then the other thing I think that's going to be critically important is an easy to take and a quick response on testing. And so vaccine, therapeutics, testing, all are part of the Shark Tank concept. They're talking about a warp speed view toward a vaccine. That's exactly what we're talking about as part of the whole Shark Tank process.
Senator, one last question here for you. We keep hearing the calls to make sure that from this point on, the manufacture of drugs, of vaccines, of PPE is done in America, along with pharmaceuticals, of course. How do we ensure that that actually happens this time? Because we've been debating this for years, and now we find out how urgent that actually is.
Well, in the CARES bill, in that big bill, not the one we just did to clean the big bill up and do things that needed to be to fill in the gaps in the CARES bill, Senator Durbin and I actually proposed an idea. We work together on some things. There are a lot of things we don't agree on, but one was to have a crash study by the National Science Foundation of our supply chain, for PPE, the protective equipment, a supply chain for medical devices, a supply chain for pharmaceuticals. I think we're going to be looking at lots of supply chains as we get out of this and the economy generally, but the most critical one to look at is the one that impacts healthcare. That's already started. It's already funded. We hope to have some answers soon on what we need to do to have a supply chain that's more secure for America's health, and also to be sure that we have a supply chain where we don't just have a sole source for anything that we need to keep our country safe and healthy.
Senator Roy Blunt, we appreciate your time today.
Great to be with you, John.
We turn our attention now to Kansas City. Also, the southeastern portion of the state and our northern district. But we begin. Congressman Emanuel Cleaver represents the 5th District, which is the city of Kansas City, and it stretches to the east. He's also the former mayor of Kansas City, so he knows that district well. Now, Congressman, Kansas City has had a relatively small number of cases compared to St. Louis. Tell us what's happening in your district, and is there a concern you could see this spike in cases?
Well, we could, but there are some differences, and they are major, particularly as it relates to this pandemic. First, St. Louis is a much older city, and the congestion in the urban core is much tighter than it is in Kansas City. We are a city of 322 square miles. St. Louis is not even half that size. So they are congested. The other reason is that, and this is not a good thing. I wish I could say something differently, but the virus is hitting disproportionately black and brown individuals. And it's for one of the reasons is the congestion. St. Louis has a larger black population than Kansas City. We have a larger Latino population in Kansas City than they have in St. Louis. But I think also St. Louis has a lot more traffic coming in and out. The suburbs are much larger, and they have many more chances for this disease to move around. We are fortunate in Kansas City that we have not had an explosion. And that's why I'm still pushing for folk to respond positively to the instructions we've been given in terms of social distancing and also sheltering in place. It's tough, but we've got to do it. We can keep these numbers down if we work together and don't give in to the virus.
You know, Congressman, a couple of things here. Two-pronged question here. One, what is your administration doing to help out leaders in Kansas City if you see an uptick? And secondly, you know, if we start to see these numbers go up again, having to shelter in place again for the second time, I can't imagine how that turns out. How would you put that back in place effectively?
Well, sheltering in place is extremely important. But we've been told by the scientists that if we go too soon, if we move too rapidly, that the second surge could be far more deadly than the first. So we've got to work to make sure that that doesn't happen, that there's no second surge. The other thing is that we have appropriated dollars. For example, right now, in the money that was given to Jackson County, they have money for testing. They have money also for the indigent care hospitals. And I think working with the 8 cities, I think, or so in Jackson County, they will be able to provide cities with some of the help that they'll need locally. This is something that everybody in the state's got to work together, because I don't think any one city or one region of the state of Missouri can do this separately and independently.
Yeah, okay. One more here. Viewer question. Alan Lee Summit writes, I miss sports. Don't we all? When do you see sports returning? Now, you guys have the Super Bowl champion Chiefs over there. It's a state known for sports teams and sports fans. On the eastern side, people want to see the Cardinals. So what does that look like? How do we get back to that point, or do we even see that this year?
Well, don't forget the fact that this is the home of the Kansas City Chiefs. You did the right thing by mentioning that.
I had to.
South Korea has already resumed its baseball season. And they did so because they've had massive testing. Now, they did begin without fans, so we may have to think about that. I don't want to miss the baseball season, nor can I even remotely give any consideration to missing the football season. But it's going to be a different kind of a season, I think, in baseball and in football. And it's something we're just going to have to live with. I think we can still have a great team. We can be great fans. But there's no point in us saying things are not going to change, because they're going to change. What we have to do is reduce the drama when those changes occur.
Okay. Congressman Emanuel Cleaver in Kansas City, appreciate your time today, and we will talk to you soon. Let's head towards southeast Missouri in the Boot Heel. That is District 8, and that is where we find Representative Jason Smith. All right, Congressman Smith, what are your biggest concerns in your district right now, encompassing the Boot Heel and a big swath of southeast Missouri?
You know, John, what I'm hearing from people across southern Missouri is that they just want to get back to work. What everyone wants is to have life normal again. Our country was founded on the ideas of personal choice and liberty, The government cannot and should not manage the risk for the individual. We have to do that for ourselves. Everyone has to decide what is best for themselves. The government should not tell us how to live. All of us are united as Americans by our love of the U.S. Constitution and the Bill of Rights. These are the rules by which all of us live by. They were in place long before any of us, and they'll be around long after any of us. We have to adhere to that and not infringe on anyone's rights. The folks here in South Missouri, like myself and President Trump, know that Americans make their own decisions and don't need the heavy hand of the government to control their lives.
Okay, viewer question right here. Jason from Cape Girardeau writes, healthcare workers are risking their lives in the battle against COVID-19. How do we get them hazard pay? What would that look like anyway, Jason, when you talk about hazard pay? Because we have a lot of people who are putting their lives on the line every day for this.
You know, our healthcare workers are risking a lot. They are warriors. They're the heroes fighting on the front lines. And I want to thank each and every one of them across this state for their tireless work during these difficult times. Back in mid-March, at the beginning of this outbreak, I held a call with all of our healthcare providers, our doctors and first responders, to hear about what resources they need. I've continued to stay in touch with them and offer my assistance. I would tell this gentleman from Cape Girardeau that the way that we go about getting them hazard pay is by having Speaker Pelosi allow the U.S. House of Representatives to meet and allow members to discuss proposals to help their communities, their districts. Unfortunately, Speaker Pelosi is trying to block out our members so she can unilaterally negotiate the next coronavirus response legislation. The needs of rural Missouri are not the same as those desires of San Francisco.
Very quickly, speaking of those diverse needs, I've been speaking with Dr. Ed LaValle, who's an infectious disease physician there in Cape, and he points out that Cape has seen a lot of cases. Outlying areas like Oregon, Howell, some of the other counties in the Boot Heel are pretty much unscathed. Those areas can be overlooked with funding because they're not getting a lot of attention. So what do you do to make sure those areas, even though they're being hurt by not working, that they still get the funding they need to get back to normal?
You have to be the squeaky wheel. We've made it a priority from day one, whenever this pandemic started, of being in contact with our small businesses, our healthcare professionals, our farmers, our veterans, and hearing their individual concerns and relaying those individual concerns back to House and Senate leadership and also President Trump. And a lot of great things have been accomplished from those conference calls that we've been able to get progress from the administration. One is telehealth. It is great that the administration, after our pressing, eliminated the requirement that you have to have visual conduct. You can have audio, but also to have visual to do telehealth was ridiculous in an area like in Southeast Missouri where we don't even have broadband in some areas. How can you do visual? You don't have cell phone service. So hopefully now with the administration making it where they can just do it by a phone call, and seniors can talk to their doctors, get their prescription drugs. That was promising. So when you're looking at 30 counties, you have to look at all different ways in order to fulfill those needs of the folks in Southeast.
All right, once again, Congressman Jason Smith, Southeast Missouri, appreciate your time today. Also joining us today is Congressman Sam Graves. He is from the 6th District, and he's got a unique district. It stretches all the way from Illinois, all the way over to Kansas, Nebraska, up along the border with Iowa. It's a huge area, a lot of diverse needs. Look at the district right there. Now, Congressman, in your district, by the way, is also St. Joseph. There's a meatpacking plant there that, last check, had 400 confirmed cases of COVID-19, although nearly all of the positive cases didn't show symptoms. Okay, what do you understand why people are concerned in that area. What are you hearing from people in that area?
So it is a real problem. And the problem with packing facilities or meat processing facilities is they're just not conducive to social distancing. I mean, they're literally shoulder to shoulder working those processing lines. So what's happening is, and I know that the facilities out there, the meat processing facilities, are taking a look at this on how they can spread people out. They're trying to figure out, just how effective, if providing the PPE, whether it's masks, they all wear gloves anyway, and some things like that, if it is going to be effective. The bigger problem is, if we were to shut down those plants, then the entire food processing or distribution chain starts to break down and it backs everything up. And then all of a sudden we have problems with the producers out there and nothing to do with that livestock and that meat. And the fact of the matter is the country has to be fed. So we're rapidly working through this process right now, trying to figure out just exactly what can be done and how quickly we can do it. Retooling these plants is something that is being looked at, but that's going to take a lot of time and a lot of effort just to be able to spread people out that 6 feet. So it's a big problem, and it's something that we're trying to address.
Yeah, your district stretches the entire top part of Missouri, mostly rural areas. So, you know, kind of like in the southeast portion of the state, you have different needs than maybe they have in St. Louis or Kansas City. What sort of needs are there up there in an area that's pretty much been unscathed right so far that we may not realize?
So one of the things we've learned in the whole process of staying at home is when people are trying to run their business or, you know, doing things like this over the internet, is we are very lacking when it comes to high-speed internet. And it's something that, you know, that we've talked about for a long time, deploying broadband and getting that high-speed internet to everyone out there. But we have learned that, you know, whether it's going to school or taking classes or it's telemedicine, as Jason pointed out, or it's just running your business, without high-speed internet, it makes it very, very hard to get through the day. You know, if your signal is dropped or you can't get through or whatever the case may be. So that's something that we've identified is not only a priority, but it's an extreme priority and something that that we need to take a hard look at and make sure that it's done quicker rather than later.
Yeah, one thing that's come up time and again in the show this evening is we've started to relax social distancing for a lot of people. If we have to go back now and say, okay, we have to do it again because we have an uptick in cases, I don't know how that happens. Do you foresee something like that happening, especially in a district like yours that hasn't seen many cases? How do you tell your people who've started doing business again that you have to go back to your houses?
Well, and that's a hard thing to do, particularly when we're in, for instance, planting season right now. For the most part, all of your rural areas, business has to go on and that crop has to get in the ground. And we're seeing, just that exact thing. And the virus isn't going away. Regardless of whether we get the country back or the economy back online or how soon that is going to be, the virus isn't going away. And I think the new norm is obviously going to be social distancing, staying 6 foot away from an individual, wearing a mask if you're close to that, washing your hands regularly, often. I think that is the new norm. And that's what we're going to have to practice. Eventually, we're going to have to open the economy back up and get the country moving again. And that's,
Okay, and he is having some internet troubles right now, I do believe. And we're not going to get him back. Okay, so let's see if we can pull up Representative Cleaver once again, see if he is still around so we can talk to him a little bit more about what's going on in Kansas City. Hey. If we can pull him back up. Okay, Congressman, one more for you here. Okay, sure. As we start to go back to whatever the new normal is or the lack thereof, right, what are you encouraging your constituents to keep in mind so that we don't go back too soon to the way it was and put us at more risk?
Well, look, it's going to require that all of us do things that we've never done before. And as Sam Graves just mentioned, we have a new normal. I mean, I wear gloves whenever I'm outside of my home. I have a mask right here on my desk. And I think we're going to have to realize that when we're doing this, we're not protecting ourselves so much, we're protecting others. And then we're also protecting our families because we don't want to take it back home. But at the same time, everybody's got to think when they go out, I'm going to protect others, and hopefully there are people out there who want to protect me. We can get beyond this. We can win this battle. There's going to eventually be, probably won't be as soon as people are declaring, we're going to have some kind of a vaccine. We don't have a vaccine for HIV. Most people think that it's been controlled and stopped because we came up with a vaccine. We have not. But we found out how to treat it and reduce, almost eliminate the deaths. That may happen here. But we can't give in. We can't give out. We've got to understand that even if it's dark right now, that there's light on the other side. And that's the only way to make it is with the hope that we can endure this and come out better on the other side as a nation and as individuals.
Okay, and we're going to go back now to Congressman Graves one more time here. We want to get him in one last chance because he's also on the Transportation Committee, a ranking member there, and also a pilot. So Lexi from Kirksville asked this question. When do you think we can start getting on a plane and going on vacation again? Lexi asked the question. It's what everybody in Missouri is thinking right now. What are you hearing?
That's a great question. The good news is, at least right now, the airlines are now all requiring masks to be worn if you're going to fly to protect the flying public. I think that we're going to start seeing more and more people fly. And there's a lot of myths out there that people don't realize, too. A lot of folks think that when you get in to an airliner that air is circulated within and is spreading all kinds of germs. That's just simply not the case. That air is exhausted outside the aircraft and new air comes in. So things like that, we don't have to worry so much about. And I'm going to, there's a lot of people that are flying right now, not nearly as many as there were before. But again, we have to get the country back up and going. But we also have to, to remember that we are protecting other people. So, whether it's wearing gloves or wearing that mask, staying 6 foot apart, spreading out, whatever the case may be, that's what we're going to have to do and wash our hands. So that's the new norm.
Well, we hope it gets back to that very quickly. Congressman Sam Graves, do appreciate it. And that concludes our conversations with Missouri's congressional delegation this evening. Again, we want to thank all 8 members of the House and our 2 senators for joining us today on this conversation. So the question now is, where do we go from here in Missouri and across the country? Nearly every medical expert we've spoken with says that Missouri is on the path to recovery, but there will be some bumps along the way. But it's good to know that the solution to this pandemic will probably have some Missouri roots. We know that the initial phase of testing with remdesivir was done at St. Louis University, which is on the forefront of medical research. We know that Pfizer in St. Louis has also been picked to manufacture the potential vaccine. You also have the infectious disease doctors in Kansas City at Mizzou's Medical School and the great hospitals across the state who are saving lives with groundbreaking treatments. We've heard the stories of nurses who have put the lives of others ahead of their own, even camping outside their own homes so to be close to their families, but not too close to infect them. Yes, it's been tough for everyone. Missourians aren't meant to be separated. We are meant to be together, and that time is coming soon. As we near our state's 200th birthday in 2021, this will be a part of our history that none of us will ever forget. But we aren't out of the woods quite yet. We will get through this, but it will take time, patience, and a lot of hard work. But we have faced tough times before, and we will overcome once again. So once again, I want to thank all the lawmakers who took time out of their busy schedules to give us some insight into what's happening in their areas that's going to impact all of our lives. It is rare to have the entire congressional delegation in one place at one time, so we are truly thankful for their time. And I want to thank you for joining us across the state of Missouri for this COVID-19 congressional town hall. I'm John Brown. Good night.